Welcome back, Physics 30. So continuing on here with the last section of the acceleration and centripetal uniform circular motion. So the acceleration that we figured out on the previous page, so A equals V squared over R, we derived how we came up with V squared. And of course we call that AC for, I guess it was AR for radial circular. Sometimes it's referred to as AC as well, because it's called centripetal or radial acceleration. And the key thing here points towards the center. So even though if I'm, like, for example, whirling a ball on the end of a string, it's going at a constant speed around. And you would think that it's a constant velocity as well, but again, velocity depends upon speed and direction. So speed has magnitude only, because it's a scalar quantity. Magnitude only, and velocity has a magnitude and direction. So if this is the same and this is the same, the reason why velocity changes is because of the direction. And what causes that change? So if you look at the pin at any instantaneous velocity for going around in a circular motion clockwise, the velocity would be in this direction at that point in time. The velocity would be here at this point of time. The velocity here would be like that at that point in time. Okay? And what causes that velocity to continually change direction? It must be an acceleration that's not changing the quickness of it, not changing the magnitude, but it's changing direction. So it works towards the center of the circle. That's one thing you need to remember, is that the acceleration is in towards the center, which causes the velocity to be continuously changing. And what's changing? The direction of it. So that leads us to this question. Example, which way will the object go? An object is in uniform circular motion. At point O, it is released. So we could think of the string as being snapped. Does the object move along a straight path between OA, or does it go OP? And of course, from discussing it here, it's tangent at that particular move. It moves off tangent. So hitting that one place, just like how we drew a tangent line there. So of course, the velocity vector is angled down to the right at that instant. Therefore, if let go, the object would go in the path of OA, because it's a straight line at that particular point. So it's going around clockwise. So it wants to keep going. It'll keep going in that direction if the string snapped, as opposed to wanting to keep in the circle. To keep it in the circle, you have to have that string there causing that inward acceleration. But if we don't have that set up, it just goes off tangent to the path. All right, with that said, we'll look at this last example here, which is a bobsled going around circular paths here. And we're going to take a look at the acceleration. So the bobsled track contains turns with a radii of 33 meters here and a 24 meter radius over here around this curve. So notice we complete the circle here so we can figure out what is that radius. Now find the centripetal acceleration at each turn for a speed. So we're assuming this bobsled is going down at a constant speed of 34 meters per second. Okay, which is around, I don't know, about 120 kilometers per hour. Multiply that by 3.6 and you would get your kilometers per hour answer. Now we want to have our A values in terms of so many G's. So you feel the effects of 1G right now being on the surface of the planet. So when you sit in the chair, for example, you're feeling 1G of force. Okay, so we're going to see how this compares. So again, A equals V squared over R. And I can put AR here for radial acceleration. I think that's how I have it on the sheet that you have. Or I think I just have it as A maybe. So let's look at the first one here. So we're going at 34 meters per second. And around the bigger circle, we get 35 meters per second squared. And I'll get you to leave some room right here. And we'll do the second one, A equals V squared over R. So 34 squared over, this time it's a tighter turn, 24. And you can see, if I'm dividing by a smaller number, a tighter turn, you're going to experience more G's there. 48 meters per second squared. Okay? And, of course, if you're on, there's a ride similar at the exhibition in which you spin around really quickly, and you can feel the side of the cart pushing you, and you know that it's greater than acceleration due to gravity because you kind of feel the forces associated with that when that cart is pushing against you. If you're standing on the ground or sitting in a chair, you feel the effects of the force that 1G can contribute to. So you can tell how that's going to react. So let's see here. 35 meters per second squared. And we know that one quote unquote G is 9.8 meters per second squared. Because that's what we experience on Earth, right? So if we cancel that off, we get 3.6. G's. So that tells us that going around this corner, we would feel as if it was 3.6 G's. So the effect is if we were on a planet that had an acceleration due to gravity 3.6 times 9.8. 3.6 times of what we feel. If I do this one, meters per second multiplied by, now 1 G is 9.8 meters per second squared. So if I cancel that off, I'm going to get 4.9 quote-unquote G's. So 4.9, so you can see greater acceleration there. And of course, we kind of associate G's with G-force, and the force that we feel that's associated with that acceleration. So you can see the effects that you would feel going around there. Right now, you feel the effect of 9.8, or of 1G, which is 9.8 meters per second. But of course, take that, multiply by 3.6, or 4.9. These are the forces that you would feel associated with these higher numbers. All right, so you should be able to do the assignment now, and that'll be the end of FM 1.9, and we'll see you again.